Hello, I welcome you all for this webinar session. Today's webinar is to be by Dr. Adeline Prinzi on CRISPR, a molecular weapon to combat infectious diseases. Dr. Prinzi did her MSc in marine biotechnology from Mananmaniyam Sundaranar University. Her PhD was once again in marine biotechnology in specialization of endocrinology from Mananmaniyam Sundaranar University. Currently, she is the Associate Dean Research in Sastra Deemed University. Before going into the talk, I would like to introduce about Sastra University. Sastra University is a composite university with 12,000 students and approximately 700 faculty members. We have 5 engineering schools and 9 of our programs are internationally accredited by IIT. We have 9 internationally accredited BTech programs, and there are also schools of law, management, education, arts, humanities, and other sciences. And Sastra University is well known for merit-based admissions and its transparent policies and contemporary curriculum with strong focus on practice and research. And we are also consistently ranked by most of the ranking authorities, most of the national as well as the international ranking authorities. And School of Chemical and Biotechnology in Sastra University has about 900 UG students and 260 PG students, which we see as the strength of our school. And there are about 110 faculty members, most of them with 90% of them with a PhD, and the remaining are pursuing their PhD. And there are a biotechnology department, bioinformatics department, bioengineering department, chemical engineering departments here. SCBT, or the School of Chemical and Biotechnology in Sastra, also has several research centers. And there are more than 50 research laboratories and 65 ongoing research projects, and 80 research projects have been completed. So the centers are CARISM, the Center for Advanced Research in Indian System of Medicine, CENTAR, which is a Center for Nanotechnology and Advanced Biomaterials. And we also have a Center for Preclinical Studies, Center for Research in Infectious Diseases, CREED, which is the organizer of this webinar. And we also have a Center for Energy Storage and Conversion. More about CREED, the Center for Research in Infectious Diseases. It is comprised of 12 faculty members and their corresponding labs from the School of Chemical and Biotechnology. And there are 8 completed extramurally funded research projects to the tune of 2.2 crores. And there are 12 ongoing research projects in this center with approximately 3.75 crores, which are supported by various funding agencies such as DST, DBT, BIRAC, and ICMR. This Center for Research in Infectious Diseases, as you could see, has major thrust areas. Most of the pathogenesis research on bacterial pathogenesis, viral pathogenesis, neglected diseases, parasitology, everything. We also offer BTech programs, UG, in bioengineering, in bioinformatics, biotechnology, and chemical engineering. Apart from that, we also offer a UG program in bioophthalmology, which is in collaboration with Sankar Nethralaya. The PG programs which we offer in our school are MTech in Big Data Biology, which we have started this year, and MTech in Industrial Biotechnology, MTech in Medical Nanotechnology, and there are also 5-year integrated MTech programs in Biotechnology and Medical Nanotechnology. Apart from that, we have an MSc Biotechnology, MSc Chemistry, MSc Bioinformatics, MSc Molecular Genetics, and an MOP program, which is also offered in collaboration with School of Optometry, Sankar Nethralaya. And we also have MSc Integrated program in Chemistry and Biotechnology. And of course, we also have several PhD programs in all fields of specialization of the school. You can also follow us in the social media through this Facebook and through our Twitter handle. And And our website, www.sastra.edu, would also give you all information about Sastra University. Thank you very much. And now I request Dr. Adeline Princey to take over this virtual platform. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Let me share my Is it visible?
Yes, it's visible, ma'am.
Yes, thank you. It's always been, so great to be a part of GRIT annual meet and talk about a molecular weapon, CRISPR-Cas, which could combat infectious diseases. What are infectious diseases? There are several infectious agents like bacteria, virus, fungi, helminth, and protozoa, and their interaction with the with their host bring about a lot of pathological changes in their host tissue and body parts, which we could observe as signs and symptoms, probably a way to lead as a progression of disease. Apart from causing disease, it also affects the social life, and we are one sole victim who is presently affected by one of the infectious agent virus, that is COVID-19. And at this point, I would like to refer one important, that is the pathogen always make its relation with the host with the help of their virulence determinants. And also like to emphasize one point that our team at Sastra is involved in understanding bacterial infection. So I would concentrate more on talking about how bacterial virulence helps the pathogen to establish its relation with their host. So in support to whatever the statement that I claimed in my previous slide, Professor Roy Michael Robbins from Department of Microbiology and Immunology, University of Melbourne, he also states that most bacteria that cause disease only produce the factors they need for this when they are at the site of infection in their host. So the factor what he refers here is the virulence determinants. He also states that if we can stop this from occurring, the bacteria will be harmless. So it drives our curiosity to know what exactly the virulence factor refers to, and is there any way to quantify the bacterial pathogenicity? So this is a simple illustration what you can find here. It's a bacterial cell which express n number of virulence determinants. Against each virulence determinant, a specific tag is quoted here. Say for example, in type 1 fimbriate, it's mentioned as adherence, and this is one of the virulence determinant which plays a very critical role for the pathogen to adhere to the host. So likewise, the entire virulence determinants of the bacterial cell, based on the way they relate with the host, they are being classified as classified in three different categories, like adherence, invasion, and colonization factors. So of course, there are methods to quantify the pathogenicity. In a way, it is expressed by the ratio of number of individuals developing clinical illness to the number of individuals exposed to the microorganism. So now the question comes, is there any way to discern bacterial virulence? Of course, there are many strategies, and one such strategy comes as a part of conventional method, that is using antibiotics or anti-virulence agents. Of course, this particular method do not directly target the virulence, but by killing bacteria, it sees that the bacteria do not exhibit virulence and establish its relation with the host. But what happens is, when bacteria is overdosed with antibiotics, you impose very strong selective pressure over them. So to overcome the pressure, they adapt different strategies to neutralize the antibiotic or antibacterial agents, like overexpressing efflux pump and efflexing out the antibiotics and neutralizing the activity, or modifying the drug target in a way the affinity of antibacterial agent or antibiotic interaction is being neutralized at this point, or modifying the cell membrane protein. So in a way, the permeability is being affected. So of course, their action will not be seen. And the other mechanism is, sometimes the antibiotic or antibacterial agents will be modified by adding certain chemical groups. Suppose if it is if it is modified with the phosphate group, then it interaction with the translational machinery gets affected. So in a way, any one of these strategies would help the bacteria to acquire super character, to become a super bug, and their reproductive fitness increases in a population, and they outgrow naturally the weaker section. So the weaker section whom I refer here is the susceptible sensitive strain. They at one point they get completely eliminated and you find only the superbug. So it is a simple statistics. By the year 2050, we could expect 10 million deaths because of antimicrobial resistance, which means 1 person could die every 3 seconds. So when we could hear the word resistance, it's really very, very scary. But again, as a researcher, we don't sit quiet. We look forward to know, is there any strategy to overcome the point resistance? Of course, there are other strategies, and one important is anti-virulent strategy. It's exactly like a walkie-talkie mechanism in bacterial system. So the walkie-talkie which I refer here is the bacterial communication. So again, I want to emphasize here our team in Shastra. As I said, we are involved in bacterial infections, to understand bacterial infection, and more specifically to understand the bacterial communication. So as we have our own language of communication with our neighbors, friends, so likewise bacteria use small signals like peptides, small chemical molecules, to interact with their type of cells, with their type of cells or with the other other unrelated species. So it could be interspecies or intra-species communication. So this communication is something very important for the bacteria to express the virulence determinants. And one of the virulence determinants is a gabler hook, which is an adhesin molecule that is very critical for the bacteria to aid the first line of interaction with the host. And poison, toxins, they are responsible to neutralize the host immune system as well as secretory system. They inject effector molecules, which again neutralize the host immune system. So antivirulent strategy involves either degrading the signal and blocking the entire downstream communications, or modifying the receptor that could interact with the signal, again bringing about downstream effect and completely repressing all the virulence factors and trying to eliminate the pathogen interaction with the host. So there are a lot more interesting fact about this anti-virulence strategy. There are increased repertoire of pharmacological targets, and these anti-virulent agents, they are quite novel based on their novel mechanism of action. And of course, we are using the strategy not to kill bacteria. So the selective pressure imposed over them will be very, very less. So it reduces the resistance development. That is something which we could see as a progress from the earlier conventional method. And at the end, whatever the anti-virulent agent that has come across, every one is target specific. So probably it could not affect the gut microbiota commensals. So that is what we trust. But with all these interesting information, again, there exist certain challenges, so which we also come across in our work. There are, for certain bacterial system, there are no well-established screening methodology. And since bacteria to bacteria, the virulence mechanism is completely different. So whatever the virulence anti-virulent agent that is present at this point of time, they are narrow spectrum. So these are the challenges, but still this is something that gives a little happiness, but still we are not completely satisfied. And with an expression of little sad, we have to move on to know, is there any other strategy? So this is one paper which I read in the year 2019, which talks about, which says that scissors get stuck. Another way bacteria use CRISPR-Cas9 that repress gene activity, which is important for virulence. That was something very interesting, but little confusing. So which actually stimulated me to know more about what exactly CRISPR-Cas refers to. So CRISPR-Cas, it's a clustered regulatory interspace short palindromic, you could find out here, short palindromic repeats, and which is present in the CRISPR loci, where you could see interspersed with spacer region, and very in close proximity you find CRISPR associated genes which express CRISPR associated proteins. And this CRISPR locus was first observed in Escherichia coli by an Osaka University researcher by the name Ishino in the year 1987. And it was observed that 90% of archaeal, by nature, they have this CRISPR locus, and 40% of bacterial genome possess this CRISPR locus. And in bacterial system, it was understood that this CRISPR-Cas act as a tool, it provides immunity for the bacterial system against the invading foreign DNA. Probably it would be the outcome of phage infection or by conjugative plasmids. And this is about the structural organization of CRISPR-Cas. As I mentioned earlier, there were n number of repeats which were short palindromic, and where you could see interspersed with spacer region. So the length of the spacer region varies organism to organism and within the same organism. And they say that it might vary between 21 to 48 base pair, but they are non-repetitive region. And this is one of the spacer is marked as red color. So this is the spacer region which act as a memory to recognize the incoming foreign sequence, and which is referred as protospacer. And again, the length of this protospacer also varies organism to organism as well within the organism, which might be 26 to 72 base pair. And with the help of this, it sees that it blocks the complete progression of the incoming DNA, foreign DNA. And apart from that, you could also see a leader region, which is the main control point of this entire CRISPR and Cas gene cassette, and which actually dictates the direction of transcription. So there are several components in the CRISPR-Cas. One of the major components is single guide RNA, which is a chimera of transacting RNA as well CRISPR RNA. And this guide, single guide RNA, which makes a target specific interaction of about 20 base pair interaction and strictly follows Watson and Crick base pairing. And again, PAM motif, that is proto-spacer adjacent motif, which is a three-letter signal sequence, N, which refers to any residue followed by two gonine, which act as a signal for the guide RNA to make base pairing exactly opposite to this particular strand. And this light shade refers to the Cas protein. This Cas protein has a dual function, helicase as well nuclease. So the helicase, you know, it favors unwinding the target DNA and favoring the guide RNA sequence to make interaction with the target region with the support of this PAM motif, and then stimulate the nuclease activity and introduce double strand break. And so there are three major types of CRISPR-Cas: type 1, type 2, and type 3. All the three type of CRISPR-Cas, they are differentiated with the tagged Cas protein. So type 1 CRISPR has Cas3, type 2 Cas9, and type 3 it has Cas10. And apart from that, these major types have several subclasses too. Type 1 has 5 different subclasses like 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, 1E, and 1F. And 1B was found to occur in most of the Campylobacter species. And type 2, which has 3 subtypes, that is represented over here. And type 2A is present in Streptococcus, type 2B in Legionella, and type 2C you could find out. Again, within that you can find different structural organization that is complete. In both the case, you find a variation in the orientation of the transacting RNA, and the upper type of organization was observed in Escherichia, and the lower type of organization of type 2C was observed in Campylobacter jejuni. So type 3 CRISPR-Cas system is subclass to 3A and 3B. So I just want to understand like how exactly it works. So there are three different stages. In the first stage, it's spacer acquisition. So here, this is the foreign DNA. We could assume probably it would have come from the phage or by conjugative plasmid, and a portion of it, which they have referred as a spacer. So this region get inserted in the CRISPR locus. So it exactly work like our human immune system. Suppose if a foreign agent come and invade us for the first time, then our immune system, we have our memory cells to store the information about the foreign body. So the next time when the same molecule comes and attack, already this is the protospacer. So already the memory is over there. So with the help of this memory, completely target this particular incoming DNA sequence. So the first step is spacer acquisition. So after spacer acquisition, the CRISPR RNA biogenesis happens. Since I was talking about there are three major classes, so here in the diagram also I have shown three major classes, how by CRISPR RNA biogenesis, after the RNA transcription processing step. So however it get processed, every CRISPR RNA will have the memory retained. So with the help of the respective Cas protein, helicase activity, the target will be recognized with the help of this guide RNA, and PAM also supports for this 20 base pair complementary base pairing, and that stimulates the nuclease activity of the Cas protein. So there is double strand break and the target DNA get completely degraded and gone. So this is how the CRISPR-Cas in bacterial system works. So as I was trying to explain about how it works, we understand the important role of Cas protein. So I had the curiosity to know whether this Cas protein has any interlink with bacterial virulence, because we could see that bacteria grow when they invade the host animal system. It's not all the bacteria can grow in all the the environment. It cannot survive in every regions within the host. So they invade a particular host region where they are being exposed to different host niches. So I was trying to know, so this is a better illustration where you find that bacteria growing in different host niches. And researchers were trying to understand about the Cas protein expression under that particular condition. So the red indicates the heat map, what you could see here. The red indicates the induction of the Cas protein, and blue indicates the repression of Cas protein. So you could find out under certain environmental condition where you find different bacteria grows in different host niches, getting exposed to different environmental conditions, where you find differential pattern of expression of Cas protein. So since we had the curiosity to know how it get interlinked with virulence, so there were few evidence which we could get. So out of which three I would like to present here. One of the proof was like, we all know that Streptococcus mutans is a primary karyogenic pathogen which serves oral environment. So researchers were more interested to know when this pathogen is trying to grow with the oral microbiota. So what is the level, how exactly the Cas protein expression reflect to that? So when they were trying to analyze, they found that out of these many number of Cas protein, 5 Cas genes which belongs to type 1E and 2A were induced. So that's something very interesting to be noted here. And we all know about the Reliquiae, which is which express protease, and that's very important for the pathogen to survive in the oral environment. And when they knocked out this particular gene, so they could find out out of all the Cas protein, only Cas 8 was induced to express. So other all proteins were downregulated. And SPX operon is very important for S mutants, because this is one this factor provide it gives an opportunity for the pathogen to to tolerate the environment, whatever that they are getting exposed in oral environment. And at that point, they could see that all the Cas protein gets induced to expression. Again, they have done an experiment where they have grown this S mutans in rich medium containing starch and sucrose, which could favor the pathogen to form biofilm. At that point, all the Cas protein was induced to express. And one point which I forgot to mention in my earlier PPT, S mutans is one, most probably they say that a pathogen might possess more than one CRISPR-Cas types, but S mutans, they understood that it has all the types of CRISPR-Cas system. So this is one example where we find CRISPR-Cas protein as S mutants have some relation with biofilm protease and stress tolerance factors. There is one more, the other proof that comes from Jegens et al. In the year 2009. They have done quite a good amount of work to relate the CRISPR-Cas interlink with the virulence, biofilm and swarming. So they have used the model organism Pseudomonas aeruginosa PA14. And this particular organism naturally, it harbored type 1F CRISPR cassette. And they could observe that when this particular pathogen was infected with, when it was lysogenized with bacteriophage DMS3, the propagation of this bacteriophage was prevented, as well biofilm and swarming motility was also affected. So here you could see you know, in the abs, in when the pathogen was not lysogenized, you could see in the wild type swarming motility and biofilm is observed. When the pathogen was lysogenized with bacteriophage DMS3, both the phenotypes were completely eliminated. And when they knocked down the memory, that is the protospacer, they found still the phenotype exhibited. And in the knockdown memory, in the memory lockdown strain, they lysogenized with bacteriophage DMS3, and they found that since the memory was knocked down, it was not able to recognize the incoming foreign DNA. So the phenotype, the virulence phenotype, still existed, exhibited, and they in the memory lost strain, they complemented with the memory, but it was not lysogenized. So both the phenotypes were observed. But in the memory complemented strain, when it was lysogenized with DMS3, they could see both the phenotypes to be disappearing. So the results were very interesting. But the point is, they want to know that why Pseudomonas aeruginosa, it affects, why biofilm and swarming motility gets affected in Pseudomonas aeruginosa in response to bacteriophage DMS3. So that is what they want to understand. So they have tried to answer for this question, for the question that they had raised. So they say that probably the bacteria doesn't want the phage to get disseminated in a bacterial community. So once when they are lysogenized with bacteriophage, they see that they quarantine themselves away from group behavior. Group behavior refers to the virulence, biofilm, and swarming motility in a way to reduce the chance of infecting the larger community. So even this small single cell organism gives us a message like how they quarantine themselves to see that the bacteriophage doesn't get disseminated and affect a larger community of their own. So we are also undergoing something similar to that. So let's follow the quarantine procedures and government procedures and see that let's not spread the infection to a larger community. So the third proof over here, it's about there is an organism with a fancy name, Francisella novisidia. This is one intracellular pathogen, and it invade the host. For this particular pathogen, there is an interesting factor, bacterial lipoprotein. So if this pathogen overexpress this character, then our TLR2 receptor could recognize it, and it would simulate all pro-inflammatory cytokine response and completely overcome the effect of this pathogen. So this pathogen uses the CRISPR-Cas platform to, downregulate or completely knock down the expression of BLP. So once when it invades, it goes in the absence of this particular lipoprotein. So our TLR2 could not recognize. So it is like that damped cytokine response. So now this fancy organism with the fancy tagged organism reaches its replicative niche in the cytosol without inducing significant inflammatory signaling. Thus, it promotes its pathogenesis. So which had an experimental proof on the other side. This is the region which shows as the target that get expressed as bacterial lipoproteins. So this is the guide RNA, how it make interaction with the target region. So in the wild type, it's understood that this expression is completely very low. But when they knock down this Cas9 protein, they could find its expression is very high. So this is a very clear indication that Cas protein has a direct or an indirect link with bacterial virulence. So it gives a very, very happy note. Apart from acting as an adaptive immune system for bacterial cells, it could also act as a positive regulator and negative regulator of virulence. So it drives me to ask a question. So, can this platform, CRISPR-Cas, selectively destroy DNA carrying antibiotic resistance or virulent genes? Of course, these genes probably comes as a part of transduction, bacteriophage infection, or by conjugation, that is by conjugative plasmids. So once it gets stably integrated, and the bacteria acquire all super characteristics to become super bugs with more reproductive fitness, to better survive and eliminate all the weaker population. So yes, this platform can be used to knock down all these ABR and virulence genes. So the question is, what should be the general protocol to be adapted to delete, edit, or knock down this antimicrobial resistance and virulent genes? In the very first step, we have to know what should be our target that has to be knocked down or they are edited or whatever. So once we choose the target, we have to introduce into the target either the PAM with the target. It should have the 20 base pair tags. It should include the tags that should be that's a spacer region with the PAM that should be recognized by the CRISPR protospacer loci. So that should be introduced. So this sequence should be completely optimized with using online tools like optimized CRISPR design, then small guide RNA scorer, sgRNA designer, chop web tool, eCrisp, CRISP finder, repeat masker. So these are the available online tools which can be used to optimize. Otherwise, what would happen? Sometimes there could be off-targeting effects. So our CRISPR-Cas system would recognize multiple regions, and probably we could end up with off-targeting. Then after the step, we have to design the small guide RNA, which is the chimera of transacting at CRISPR RNA. So that has to be assembled in a plasmid construct. So then the plasmid has to be subcloned into the target bacterial pathogen, and we have to see how it degenerates. Then if it is a addition or whatever, we can go for screening the transgenic strains for gene editing events. So if any editing in the genome happens, definitely it is going to lose restriction enzyme sites. So probably that can be understood. And whatever the changes that happens in the genome can be understood by sequencing methodologies. So with this mechanism, there exists n number of successful stories. So one successful story from Hong Kong University, work by Zhu et al. In the year 2019, I would like to refer here. So that group, what they have done is, they have used a multi-drug resistant Pseudomonas aeruginosa clinical strain, PA154197. So this strain is very important because it shares a clonal complex with two international CF isolate, and also it shows a comparable resistance profile with the high risk clone ST175, and also it harbors a type 1F CRISPR-Cas loci. So researchers thought about why not we exploit this 1F CRISPR-Cas loci to knock out these efflux pumps, which is the sole reason for this pathogen to acquire resistance for most of the antibacterial agents and antibiotics. So for which they have done two simple constructions. So for the genetic constructions, so they have gone with constructing an editing plasmid as well a targeting plasmid. So this is the targeting plasmid. So this construction was made to ensure whether the CRISPR-Cas system of that bacterial system, it's functional. So for which what they have done is they have chosen this plasmid PAY5233. So under the control of this PTAT strong promoter, they have introduced the memory. So this memory includes, a perfect design PAMP sequence too. And this is co-expressed with the LUX. And upstream to that, it also has antibiotic resistant marker. And also you could see that the spacer, the memory is flanked with, repeat region as well. It is flanked with two restrictions, unique restriction sites. So once this plasmid is subcloned into the bacteria PA154167, so this is the target that they want to knock out and completely degrade. So what happened was the CRISPR system was active. Once this memory was inserted in the MEX-B, the CRISPR system was active to recognize the target, and with the help of Cas protein, it was able to introduce double strand break. And when there is double strand break, since the system was not proficient for homologous recombinational repair, so what happened was that leads the cell to death. So when they were trying to grow the cells harboring PAY5233, they cannot enumerate any cells, so which clearly indicate that CRISPR-Cas system was active. So now by using these restriction sites, they cleaved and they reconstructed this memory in PAY5235 plasmid, which again co-expressed in Luxis. But again, one thing very interesting about this plasmid, it had a 1 KB DNA region, U1, which refers the 500 base pair upstream of the target gene, and D1 is the 500 base pair downstream of the target gene. So since both, when this plasmid was subcloned into the bacterial system, the memory was inserted into the target as well. Once the Cas system comes into picture and introduce double strand break, since between these two DNA there were homologous sequence, so what happened, there was homologous recombination repair gets activated and this entire region gets knocked out. So this is the final outcome. So this was so those clonal population where clones where the target gene that was knocked out was screened with the help of gene specific primer flanking, that is the flanking this MEX-B, MEX-E as well MEX-XH gene using a forward and reverse primer. So this is the way that they had done the construction, and this is the key observation. So when they knocked down MEX-B by this particular approach, they found that there was a downshift. The pathogen was able to, it was going back to get resensitized with all anti-pseudomonal antibiotics. So when they have knocked down this MEX-F, they could see that for levofloxacin and ciprofloxacin, it was able to get, it was resensitized. And when they knocked down MEX-H, for none of the antibacterial as well antibiotic, the pathogen was not able to resensitize. So they understand that probably this particular pump may not be essential for the resistance. But still, they had a lot of curiosity to know the additive effect of MEX-B and MEX-F. So by using the same approach, instead of knocking out one, they knocked out both the pump. So double mutant was constructed, and they found that for most of the anti-pseudomonal antibiotic and antibacterial agents, the pathogen was resensitized, and they found for this fluoroquinolone type of antibiotics, levofloxacin, ciprofloxacin, they find a sort of synergy was exhibited. So now, but the point over here, they compared the result with what they could get in PA01. So for the same two antibiotics, although it is 32-fold downshift that was observed here, but for the same two antibiotics, the MIC value was, they found it was much higher when compared to PA01. Because in PA01, the MIC for both antibiotic, it's just 0.325. So they want to know, is there any other additional genetic determinant could add FQ, that is fluoroquinolone resistance, in PA154197, so for which they could take the hint from Varughese et al. Year 2008, where he has mentioned a sort of substitutional change in Gyrae gene occurs in this particular pathogen. So they thought probably this mutation would be an additional genetic determinant for the bacteria to acquire resistance. So they have done two different constructions. So this construction includes an axillary PAM. This is the Gyrae. So they follow two different protocol, two different plasmid. One is indonor, the other one is deldonor plasmid. So in the first case, this is the Gyrae. So 475 base pair downstream of PA154197 Gyrae. They could introduce this, which has the PAMP. They understand it has the PAMP signal. So very close to this PAMP signal, they want to introduce. So the plasmid carried the flanking region of this PAMP signal, and also it had the memory tag. So with the help of this plasmid, they were able to introduce the memory. Now what they have done is they had the del donor plasmid, which had the Gyrae of PA01, and the upstream and downstream, it had the homologous region of Gyrae of PA154197. So when they using this plasmid, CRISPR would get activated and it introduced double strand break, but at the same of homologous DNA repair, this Gyrae of PA154197 was replaced with PA01. So those clones of this replacement were further confirmed by sequence by amplification using sequence specific primer seq-F and seq-R. And this was the observation. So in the case of replacement, they find, especially for these two antibiotic, there were still 8 to 4-fold downshift in the MIC value from what they observed earlier. So there are a lot more information, a lot more data, but these are few information which supports that whatever that they are trying to define here. So they say that CRISPR-Cas system in PA154197 could be manipulated to work against the cells, that is, in a way to make the cells to resensitize to the antibacterial and antibiotics. So that's a real story and it's very interesting. So according to me, the system is an ideal genome genetic engineering technology. It's because of two major reasons. So one of the reasons, it's going to be the next by drug class because of its high potency, that is cleavage efficiency and specificity. The other one is it has a broader applicability, which you can do it both in vivo and ex vivo applications. And it's a very simple editing tools, and it's a potential one-time curative treatment that's interesting about, and it gives more credential for this platform to become next by drug class. And the other major reason is the broadest potential to modulate genes, where you could see that it has the ability to address any site in the genome. And also it could target multiple sites at the same time. And it has the multifunctional programs we can do at the same time using this platform, like delete, insert, or repair genome. That's something very interesting again. So with all these interesting facts, so anywhere we could also find in parallel the challenges too. So this sort of challenge is it's quite common for whenever we come across with drug discovery. So especially translating the drugs from the developed antimicrobial or whatever from an artificial laboratory setting to a real world application, it's always a challenge for drug discovery platform. But there are added challenges for this particular tool. One is the microbial community. See, however we say that this has the massive potential of sequence specific killing, it could be manipulated to resensitize the MDR carrying bacteria or whatever, but these assessment we do it in nearly in clonal bacterial population. But the challenge is when you look into a natural community, we see billions of bacteria per gram of matrix, which would have thousands of species. Each species you will find strains, you find more clonal population, more clonal strains. They are completely different because of their drug resistance and other phenotypic characteristics. So the challenge over here is the determining resistance gene carriage by specific bacterial host within complex community. It's going to be a challenge, and of course it is time consuming. The other challenge would be like sometimes when we are targeting a particular pathogen metabolite, and due to our targeting, it might affect in some downstream effect on expression of any metabolite, which might be very critical for the other pathogens not to outgrow. Maybe that might be very important to cause major changes in the host system, especially it might affect the systemic, it might lead to systemic diseases or have interlinked with systemic disorders like diabetes, periodontitis, probably. So when we target a particular metabolite or any particular genes, we have to also consider the ecological risk. So this is one challenge that we have to face. The other one is narrow host range. Probably for the CRISPR-Cas delivery, we use phage delivery mode or conjugative plasmid or biplasmids, but they all have a narrow host range. So that would be another challenge. But of course, for every challenge can be overcome by simple solutions. So maybe if we can think about constructing phage genome with broad host range and plasmids with broad host range, so this problem could be addressed. The other one is evolution, again an important point. So over time, what happens, the gene which express Cas protein, so they also come across with changes, so which might bring about loss of Cas activity. So Cas is very important for the gene editing mechanism. So that's something which we have to look into. And also I have read from papers there are anti-CRISPR mechanism also exist. So these are the challenges, but however, these challenges could be overcome by target multiplexing. So when we target when we plan to target our own gene of interest, we can also think about parallel in mitigating the anti-CRISPR activity. So the other challenge, so anywhere we involve genome manipulation, so definitely it includes a lot of ethical and legal issues. So the current guidelines of our government do not completely support the usage of this platform to an extent. We have to engage people from different communities and work on reconsidering guidelines. More importantly, we have to have stakeholders who are the people who is going to translate this particular technology to the society. So that has to be considered. So with all these challenges into mind, and I remember the words of Mother Marie Curie. She says that nothing in life is to be feared. It is only to be understood. So now it's the time to understand more so that we may fear less. So what I, the message what I want to convey over here, this is one ideal platform which could bring about disarming back any microbial virulence that is important for establishing the host relationship. So it's time to understand more on this particular platform. So at least in future, we may fear less. So that's the point which I want to make here. So with this, I would like to introduce my own QSL family at Shastra. Always, it's a proud moment of being associated with the intellectuals. So we have collaborators from different domains, clinicians, epidemiologists, and computational biologists. Dr. Prasanna Neelakantan, he is from Hong Kong University, who is the number one endodontist in India and is a leading endodontist in the world. And he is one of my collaborator in an international project funded by Spark MHRD, and we are collaborating in n number of projects that involves more oral microbiome. And Dr. Sumana, she's a leading microbiologist cum clinicians in India, who always support me from JSS Medical College, who supports me in providing clinical strains to understand whatever I want to do. And Dr. T. Ramamurthy, he's a very leading scientist in India and a leading cholera researcher, an epidemiologist, who's always a mentor to keep me going on in this particular field of interest. Mr. Karthi, who is a computational biologist, who supports me from the beginning, long back from 2003 onwards. He supports me in computational biology because any research, if it includes drug discovery, computational biologist cannot be neglected. So he supports me for a long period of time and keep my group going on. And Alex, he helps me because whenever we try to understand the bacterial communication, we come across most of the time the regulation is mediated by RNA. So for the genomics part, he tried to support me to understand how exactly our group has to proceed with. And in our family, already 5 PhD students have got graduated. At present, I have 3 wonderful, the best students. And Ms. Sahana Vasudevan, she is an INSPIRE fellow. And she's working in 3D printer dental implant. And Mr. Gopalakrishnan, who is another good student of mine, who is working in bio-inspired catheter. And Hema Bahavadi, and another intellect of my lab, who is working in QS modulator. Then we have a bunch of project students. And it's very difficult to give all their information over here, so I have just put forth highlighted few of the senior project student of my group, Akshaya, Andrita, Aparna, Arvel, and Kamlarasi. So these are the people who keeps the family keeps running. And this is the our website details. So if any queries and any sort of collaboration or any sort of scientific interaction, you can try to reach us. You have the details posted here. You can